scripture reading this morning as we continue walking through the book of 1 Samuel. It's going to come from chapter 23. We're looking at the first 14 verses here. But if you're using a Pew Bible, you can find it on page 245. If you have your scripture text with you, please take them out and turn there to 1 Samuel chapter 23. Again, you can find this on the Pew Bible on page 245. Before we go to our text and read what God has to say for us, let us go to Him in prayer and ask Him to open our hearts and minds. We understand that which He has for us. Lord God, we do come before You. We thank You and praise You that You speak to us through Your Word. Lord, as we lift up our voices in praise and prayer to You, Lord, You don't leave us just wandering around trying to decipher what Your will is, but rather You reveal it clearly through Your Word. So we ask, Lord, You would do that for us this morning. Help us to clearly see that which You have for us, understanding Your truths, Lord, as we consider Your Word. Lord, I ask You to be with me, Your servant. Let nothing I say be untrue, but only the words You placed in my mouth. The words, Lord, intended for Your people, for building them up and edifying them, for turning hearts to Yourself and bringing glory to Your name. Lord, we ask that this might be accomplished. We ask it in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. 1 Samuel 23, beginning at verse 1. Hear now the holy, inerrant, and infallible word of God. Now they told David, "Behold, the Philistines are fighting against Keilah and are robbing the threshing floors." Therefore David inquired of the Lord, "Shall I go and attack these Philistines?" And the Lord said to David, "Go and attack the Philistines and save Keilah." But David's men said to him, "Behold, we are afraid here in Judah. How much more then if we go to Keilah against the armies of the Philistines?" Then David inquired of the Lord again. And the Lord answered him, "Arise, go down to Keilah, for I will give the Philistines into your hand." And David and his men went to Keilah and fought with the Philistines and brought away their livestock and struck them with a great blow. So David saved the inhabitants of Keilah. When Abiathar, the son of Ahimelech, had fled to David to Keilah, he had come down with an ephod in his hand. Now it was told Saul that David had come to Keilah, and Saul said, "God has given him into my hand, for he has shut himself in by entering a town that has gates and bars." And Saul summoned all the people of war to go down to Keilah to besiege David and his men. David knew that Saul was plotting harm against him, and he said to Abiathar, the priest, "Bring the ephod here." Then David said, "O Lord, the God of Israel, your servant has surely heard that Saul seeks to come to Keilah to destroy the city on my account. Will the men of Keilah surrender me into his hand? Will Saul come down as your servant has heard? O Lord, the God of Israel, please tell your servant." And the Lord said, "He will come down." Then David said, "Will the men of Keilah surrender me and my men into the hand of Saul?" And the Lord said, "They will surrender you." Then David and his men, who were about 600, arose and departed from Keilah, and they went wherever they could go. When Saul was told that David had escaped from Keilah, he gave up the expedition. And David remained in the strongholds in the wilderness, in the hill country of the wilderness of Ziph. And Saul sought him every day, but God did not give him into his hand. Do you ever notice how quickly people will turn on one another? It doesn't matter the relationship, and it doesn't matter if one has severely helped another. The issue always seems to be one of self-preservation. Just think of Billy and Susie. Their mom makes them some cookies, but she says, "You can't have them till after dinner." "Oh, but they smell so good." Susie's saying to Billy, "We gotta have some of them. Just go into the kitchen and take just a couple. Mom will never know." So she convinces Billy and goes into the kitchen and he takes a couple cookies. And Mom finds out. And she says, "Who disobeyed me?" And there's Susie. "Billy did it. He went in there. He took the cookies. He gave them to me. He said we could eat them." And there's poor Billy standing there, mouth wide open, shocked at what just happened. He can't believe what he's seeing. But this is nothing new. We see it all the time. In fact, this is why most criminals wind up in prison, because their partners in crime sell them out to cut a better deal for themselves. That's what we see in the world. It's the case every time. People will turn on someone else to protect themselves. And that's what we see in our text this morning. As we see David saving a city that is quick to turn him over in order to save themselves. And through this message, what we learn is don't find your protection in men, but find it in Christ and His Word. Three things to examine this morning. First, you must inquire of God. Second, don't presume based on your circumstances. And third, God's Word protects you. So first, you must inquire of God. Verse 1 tells us, David's been made aware that the Philistines are attacking Keilah and they're robbing their threshing floors. Right here you're seeing the answer to something that came out just a couple weeks ago. Why did Gad tell David to go to Judah? Well, here's your answer. So that he could be near Keilah, only 3 miles away, and show himself to be God's true king by providing a king's protection for his neighbor. Keilah's threshing floors, they're being robbed. What you see in that statement is this. They're out working all day and storing up grain so they can survive, so they have food to eat. But the Philistines keep coming in and stealing it. And this puts their very survival in jeopardy. Just imagine the situation. You go and work all week long, and you take your paycheck and you deposit it into a bank account. But somebody in the bank, they divert your funds into their own account. How long would you survive? As your car doesn't get paid, as you can't pay your rent or your mortgage, how do you survive if you don't have the funds necessary to buy the food and clothing, the very necessities of life that you need? That's Keilah's situation. That's what's going on right here. And David hears about this. And it's through this that you see how David is truly God's anointed king. Because David does something that Saul should have done, but never bothered to do. And that's what you see right in verse 2. David, he inquires of God. Look at verse 2. Therefore David inquired of the Lord, "Shall I go and attack these Philistines?" Notice what David's not doing. He's not just running out and doing his own thing. He's not just doing whatever he thinks is best for him and his family, for those around him and the men in the cave with him. No, what does he do? He inquires of God to seek his leading, to have God tell him what to do. So right here you're seeing firsthand David's spiritual recovery because he's seeking God's direction as to what he should do. And through David's actions, we see loud and clear that you must inquire of God. And I want you to think about that. To inquire of God. See, it means so much more than simply praying. Most of us pray for direction about situations that we face, but we never actually listen for the answer. This is because we pray apart from God's word. But how does God answer your prayers? You know how? He does it through His Word. That's why He gives it to you. Prayer and Word, they go hand in hand. Like peanut butter and jelly, you can't have one without the other. It's not enough to just pray and expect God to show up in your bedroom and speak to you. He speaks to you through His servants, and He speaks to you through His Word. So if you're praying but not reading, you know what you're doing? You're having a one-sided conversation. You inquire of the Lord through your prayers, and He responds and answers through His Word. And you see this clearly in verse 6. Look what it says in verse 6. It says that when Abiathar, the son of Ahimelech, had fled to David, to Keilah, he comes down with something in his hand. And what does he have in his hand? He's got an ephod. An ephod was a priestly garment that was used to obtain divine guidance. The ephod is key here because they didn't have a Bible. They couldn't just open up their Bibles and read. When they inquired the Lord, He spoke through the ephod. The ephod existed because the Bible didn't. So like Scripture today, the ephod back then in David's day was how God spoke to you. And you see that
Because it's through Abiathar's ephod that he tells David both to go attack the Philistines, and as you'll see in just a few moments, to get out of Dodge. Exodus 28:30. You can look at that later this afternoon, but you'll see there clearly how the ephod provides a way of knowing God's will in the absence of God's divine revelation, which we have today. You've got God's word right before you. You just need to pick it up and use it. Think about David. He knows what God wants him to do because he's got God's priest, Abiathar, with him. And Abiathar has his priestly garment and his ephod, or what you might call his pocket binder. So David inquires, and God says, go and attack the Philistines and save Keilah. David's answer comes. He knows what he wants to do. He's got to go and attack the Philistines. But no, not everyone's convinced. You see this in verse 3, where David's men say they're terrified. They're terrified to do what God says to do. They follow David out of the stronghold. Remember, they're back in the stronghold. They're protected. But they follow him out into Judah. And this alone has them scared to death. And now David's saying, listen, God wants us to go and fight the Philistine armies. And they're saying, are you sure you heard him right? Is that ephod working properly? I mean, it's scary enough out here in Judah, let alone going against the Philistines and their armies. And don't you see with that? You see what's so typical of all of us. When God speaks so clearly through his word, but it's something that we just don't want to hear, or something that's just too scary. Like how God says go, and we say no. This is what happens when you let fear control. It's what happens when you don't actually listen for God's answer. God speaks through his word and tells you which way to go. And that tells you, you don't need to resist God's word. You don't need to be confused about what to do. You can actually face your fears by inquiring of God and hearing him speak to you through his word. David knows his men's, he knows his men's fear. He knows they're afraid. So notice what he doesn't do. He doesn't attack them. He doesn't call them cowards or try and coerce them. But instead, he says, okay, let's be certain this is what God is really saying. So he goes back and he inquires once again. He spends even more time in prayer and even more time in God's word. Verse 4 says, then David inquired of the Lord again, and the Lord answered him, arise, go down to Keilah, for I will give the Philistines into your hand. It's certain that David heard God right the first time. God was really saying, go and fight the Philistines and save Keilah. But there's something else that's at it when he goes back. Did you notice that? Did you pick it up? He said, I will give the Philistines into your hand. That's significant. Remember when Saul was first anointed king? What did God tell him to do? He said, go against the Philistines. I've given them into your hand. And what did Saul say? I don't think so. I don't think I'm hearing you right. I don't think that's going to be good for me or my people. And he didn't go. He delayed. But what does David do? He shows himself to be God's true king, because when he hears God speak, he listens. Verse 5 makes this clear. David and his men went to Keilah, and they fought with the Philistines, and David saved the inhabitants of Keilah. You see what's going on through David's obedience? David listened to God. His inquiry led to the salvation of Keilah. But they weren't the only ones helped. Notice how David and his men were also helped. Think about their situation. They're hiding in a cave with no supplies, no food. God says, go attack the Philistines at Keilah. Save Keilah. David's obedient. And what happens? He walks away with the Philistines' livestock. He's got enough food for a feast. In the cave, he was starving. But through obedience to God's word, God provides in a mighty way. More food than he could possibly imagine. And this is what happens when you inquire of the Lord and follow what he says. Both you and others are blessed. Think of it this way. When you inquire of God and do what he says, everybody wins. That's the beauty of following God's word. David knew he had to rely on God's leading, but Saul's a different story, which brings us to our second point. Don't presume based on your circumstances. Think about what Saul hears. He hears how David's left the stronghold. Finally, his opportunity's come because David's left the stronghold of Adullam and he's come to Keilah. And it's in Saul's response to this information that he receives that you see Saul's presumption. Verse 7. Look at verse 7. Look what it says. Saul speaks and he says, God has given him into my hand, for he has shut himself in by entering a town that has gates and bars. Saul's looking at his circumstances and he presumes that God has just handed David over to him. Finally, what he wants, he's going to get. God is satisfying his desires by giving him David. And again, this is because of where David was and where he now is. Understand what's going on. David's in the stronghold of Adullam, which is 3 miles north and uphill from Keilah. So David's had to leave his stronghold, his strategic advantage. You know when you want a strategic advantage, what you do is you get the high ground? Well, that's where David was at. But he's left that. And he's come downhill 3 miles to Keilah. And that's not all. Keilah is a walled-up city that's got a gate on the front wall that's the only way in and the only way out. Picture the scene. David's entered this city to save the inhabitants from the Philistines, and he's walled himself in. The only way out is through these big, large wooden doors that close in the middle and have this long beam going horizontally across so you can't push them open. Think of our front doors. Go turn around. Look at the front doors here at the church. They shut the middle. Imagine if I put a bar along the outside and that was the only way in and out. You couldn't leave. You'd be stuck. That's David's situation. That's what Saul's looking at. And Saul's saying, aha, I've got him. God has delivered him into my hands. This is great. This is wonderful. Just what I wanted. And that's what happens when you presume that God's on your side because you're not looking at God's word. Think about Saul here. He thinks that David's been handed over to him. But you're sitting here saying that's not the case at all. How do you know that? Because we just read what God said to David. I'll hand the Philistines into your hands. So you know Saul's wrong in his presumption because you've got access to God's word. But what if you didn't? What would happen if you didn't know God's word and you just saw the circumstances? Think about that movie you watch. You and that person's running from the bad guys, and they're running, and they run down into the basement, and they get in the corner, and they hide behind some box, and you're thinking, are you a moron? You just trapped yourself. If they find you, there's no way out. Well, that's what David's done. That's what Saul's seeing. And that's what happens when you look at circumstances, and you presume based on your circumstances alone. Saul thinks that God is working in his favor because David's been trapped. God's providential hand led David into this walled-in city so that Saul could have what he wanted. See, circumstances can do this because they lead to false presumptions. Just like when you presume God's giving you something you really want because the circumstances suggest it's how God's providing for you, how he's answering your prayer. But is this the case? If getting what you want interferes with your worship, pulls you away from Christ's church and people, and does nothing to help you grow in your faith. Every decision you make must be governed by God's word and not just your circumstances. God speaks to you through his word and his servants and not through your presumptions about your circumstances. Brothers and sisters, don't let your circumstances lead you, but trust in God's word to do so. Saul's presumptuous because he doesn't have a priest and he doesn't have an ephod. But David had access to God's will through Abiathar's ephod. Through God's priest, God's king knew what God wanted him to do. And you know what? Just like David, you too have a priest that gives you access to your God. And your priest is much greater and much mightier than Abiathar, because you've got God's only begotten Son the Lord Jesus Christ, who opens up access to God for you. He did that by reconciling you to God, by going to the cross to pay the price for your sins, so you can now come into God's presence and hear God speak. And he does this by giving you his Spirit. You realize you wouldn't even understand the word if it wasn't for God's Spirit. Christ sent his Spirit as promised to illumine your eyes and heart and minds so you can understand what God says, what he has in mind for you, which way to go. That's what Christ does for you. That's the protection you find with Christ. What this means for you is you never have to be presumptuous because you have access to God's word. He gives that to you through his servants, through his Spirit. All too often, what we do is we pray and we say, God told me to go this way. And it's interesting because usually the way we want to go is the way that gets us out of the circumstances that we don't want to be in. Isn't it amazing how that happens? You've got some bad circumstances you don't want to be in, so you say, God, show me how to get out of them. And he gives you some way. But you never look at his word to find out if that's true or not. Are you just being presumptuous? See, Scripture speaks to you clearly. So you need to open up God's word and read it. I want you to understand something. God doesn't hide in the shadows and whisper in your ear, do this, do that, go that way. You know who does that? Satan does that. Satan hides in the shadows and whispers in your ears. And he tells you what you want to hear. He says, if it looks good, if it seems tasty, and you're hungry, you want to eat, then take and eat. What's the big deal? Don't listen to that God. He's mean. He's nasty. He wants to keep you from having what you want and what you deserve. If you feel it's right in your heart and you have a peace about it, then go for it. Do it. It'll be okay. You can trust that peace in your heart. There's no need to go any further than that. But is that what Scripture says? Scripture says God speaks to us through the preaching of his word and the reading of his word. It's so easy to be guided by some still or silent voice in your heart or your head. But that's not what ought to guide you. It's easy to pray and hear some silent response that comes into your heart or in your head and says, this is what I want you to do. Look at your circumstances and say, this must be the way God is leading you. Because I know God won't want me to suffer. Right? Does God want us to suffer? No, clearly not. His word wouldn't say that, does it? It's a whole different thing to pray with your eyes wide open, staring into God's word, seeing what he has for you to do, and actually doing it. Brothers and sisters, hear that. It's one thing to pray and be guided by some silent voice in your head or heart, but a whole different thing entirely to pray with your eyes wide open, staring into God's word, and being guided and directed by what he actually says. Let your inquiries all be like David's inquiry. Ones where you actually seek out God's will and listen to what he says rather than just following your own heart. Do this and you'll never have to be presumptuous about where God's directing you. Saul presumed God was working for him, but David, he knows he has to continue to rely on God's direction, which brings us to our third point, God's word protection. Saul's presumption leads him to gather all his troops and go get David. And I want you to see something here. Don't miss this. This is amazing to see once again how Saul overreacts. Did you pick up on it? Saul went and got all the people to go to war. Saul's calling up all 200,000 of his troops to go get David and his 600 men who God has trapped inside the walls of Keilah. You know what this is like? What Saul's doing is kind of like setting your house on fire to kill the bee that got into your house. Saul's presuming that victory is his, and to assure himself that this is what God wants, he's mustering all the forces he can. He's saying, let's go get David. But God wasn't working for Saul at all. So what does God do? He lets David know. He warns David that Saul's coming. But David's still uncertain about something. He doesn't know, should he stay or should he go? Are the men of Keilah going to turn me over? Or are they going to protect themselves? So what does David do? He doesn't hide in his closet and say, God, show me. But rather, he says to Abiathar, bring the ephod. And what does he do? He once again inquires of God. And God answers him clearly in verse 12. God says, they will surrender. David doesn't have to presume what will happen because he's asked God and God has answered. And this is the beauty of God's word. It protects you by directing you what you should do and where you should go. Think of it this way. Your Bible is the answer key. You never have to fail any test because God's given you all the answers and he's put them at your fingertips. Could you imagine having an open book exam and saying, no, I want to try it on my own? Well, God gives you an open book exam all the time. He says, and the answers are right here. Pick up and search them out. See what God's answer is. And David learned something here. He learns through inquiring of God that despite his saving Keilah, they're not going to save him. They're willing to give him up. Our text doesn't say why, but I think it's safe to assume, safe to surmise, because they're seeking to protect themselves. Think about where we're at in redemptive history here. They've just heard about how David's just run from Nob, and what happened at Nob, we just saw it last week, Saul killed all the priests at Nob. And why? Because he thought they were helping David. So if you're in Keilah, you're saying, I know what Saul just did to those guys, we're not going to chance it. Let's turn David over. Just think of the bully on the playground. What does he do? He beats up one kid and takes his lunch money. The next morning, there's all the kids with their milk money ready to hand it over. They do it for their own protection. And when there's one resistor who stands up against the bully, what does everybody else do? They stand back. They dare not get involved. They dare not interfere. They say, you're on your own, buddy. I'm looking out for myself. I'm going to protect myself. And you know this. You know this because who here hasn't silently stood by watching as another was attacked because you saw it as what was needed to protect yourself? You see it right here with the men of Keilah, and you see it every day of your life. Because when push comes to shove, men seek to protect themselves. They call it your survival instinct. But this isn't the case with Jesus Christ, who willingly surrendered himself to protect you. See, this is why you don't put your protection in men, but you put it in Jesus Christ and his word. Through his word, you'll learn how you're a sinner in need of a savior, a sinner destined for judgment, but you'll also read how Christ is that savior that you need, how he saved you so you don't have to face judgment. That's how he protects you, by saying, turn and trust in me. If you're here this morning never having done that, then do it now. Be saved and protected from the coming wrath by turning and trusting in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ served as the one mediator between God and man. Jesus Christ offers the only protection there is from the chains of the law and the sting of death. He went to the cross to protect you. He went to the cross as a means of gaining that protection that you could never get for yourself. To be truly protected from your worst enemies of sin and death, you need Jesus Christ. And you find him in his word, not hiding in your bedroom closet. This is why you want to be on your knees in prayer with your word opened up before you. Because that's where you'll find the protection you need. Protection from bad mistakes. Protection from going the wrong way. And understand this. God's protection doesn't mean a life of health and wealth. I'm going to tell you something that may shock you. You may be surprised by this. You may be like, I can't believe this, but I'm going to tell you anyway. Christians, just like everyone else, they face obstacles and hardships, loneliness and fear. But you know what's different? You know what's different for Christians? Christians can face these things without succumbing to these things, because Christ provides the protection. And he does it through his word that's filled with his guidance and his promises. Just look at David. What does he do? He follows God. He's obedient. And does that make his life better? He gets some food for the moment, but his life is still in jeopardy. He still faces threats to his life. He had to flee from Keilah. And as verse 13 says, to go wherever he could. His selfless act of coming to Keilah's rescue, it did not make him blessed and favored among men. And you know what? When you share God's grace, that will not necessarily make you blessed and favored among men. David continues to be facing a life of turmoil, of hardship, because Saul continued to pursue him every day. And in the same way, sin continues to pursue you. So make sure you see God's word and his promises. See how he ends our text here in verse 14. God didn't give Saul David. God didn't give David into Saul's hand. God kept David safe, even through his dangers. You get that? David's dangers remain, but God still protected him. And God protected David to a point by telling him, run! Run now! This is important to see, because it conveys to us all how the Christian life isn't necessarily one filled with happiness and prosperity. But it does show you that the Christian life is satiated with hope and protection. You see it most clearly in God's word as you read of how Jesus Christ went to the cross to protect you from sin and death. It's so amazing. So rarely will we give up our extra time or our extra money for the good of Christ or to assure the continuance of his church. But yet Jesus Christ, what does he do? He left his very kingdom in heaven. He left his throne in heaven. He gave up his very life to ensure that you're protected from all that life throws your way. If you want to know more about this, then go home this afternoon and open up God's word and read it. Or speak to me after the service and I can share more with it with you. Open your Bibles and see for yourself how Jesus Christ suffered and died so you might live. And not so you can live for yourself, but so you might live for him. If you want to find protection that lasts into eternity, then open up your Bibles and see what God says. See how Jesus Christ gives you life more abundant. That's what your union with Christ does for you. The world may still harass and harangue you. Men may still pursue and attack you. But you can find comfort knowing that through God's word you have his promise that he always protects you, and you see it again so clearly in the protection that comes through Jesus Christ, who's clearly visible in the pages of Scripture. Take advantage of this protection by picking up and reading. Take advantage of this protection by being in worship every week, on your knees in prayer every day, and in your word constantly. In this life, you'll be attacked by all sides. Life has a way of beating you down and leaving you feeling vulnerable, afraid, uncertain of your future, which way to go. When you're being attacked by life, when you're so overwhelmed and you don't know which way to turn, it can be almost natural to seek help and protection in whoever or wherever you can find it. But that's not what you want to do. You never want to find your protection in men. Because men will always let you down. So open up God's word and let him lead you to safety. Scripture shows you the way of salvation, and it shows you the way the Christian should walk. The world looks out for itself, while Jesus Christ looks out for you. This is why Jesus Christ, just like David left his stronghold and exposed himself to the enemy in the same way Christ did that for you. He left the safety of his throne in heaven to be born of a virgin and walk on this earth so you might be protected. Let me drive this home for you with a closing illustration. Think of yourself being out in the jungle. You're out there, it's you, some man, and Jesus. And there's a lion. And this lion's hungry. And he's prowling about. And you're hiding. And you're looking and you're saying, there's safety just a quarter mile away. We can just run from here to there, we'll be safe. And you're asking the question, can I outrun this lion? And the man turns to you and says, I don't need to outrun the lion, I just got to outrun you. And while you're thinking about this, there's Jesus going and lying his life down, laying down on the ground so he might be devoured, so that you're protected and safe. This is how both men and Jesus operate when it comes to your protection. Men seek to protect themselves, while Jesus Christ always protects you. Brothers and sisters, let this show you clearly. Don't find your protection in men, but find it in Christ and his word. Let's pray. Lord God, we do come before you this morning. We thank you and praise you, Lord, that we see right through this text, through this page of the scripture, Lord, how you offer the only protection we truly have and the only protection we truly need. Lord, just as David obeyed your word, listened to what you said, and went against the Philistines and Keilah, Lord. Through that, you saved the city of Keilah, and you also helped David, Lord. And Lord, through that, we see you pointing us to Christ, the one through whom we find protection from sin and death. Lord, as we face uncertainties in this world, as we are fearful about the future, unsure of which way to go, where to walk, Lord, help us to recognize that you protect us through your word. Help us, Lord, to be on our knees in prayer with our eyes wide open, staring into your word, searching out your scriptures, Lord. And there, we ask that you lead us, Lord. Lead us along your paths, the way we should go. And Lord, help us to show others the way to safety by pointing them to Christ. We ask all these things in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.